بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We started talking about fasting and what pertains to fasting of the important rules. In our previous lesson, we mentioned about the way fasting is commenced, and that is either by seeing the crescent of Ramadan or the completion of 30 days of Sha'ban. And this is done by monitoring the western horizon after the sunset of the 29th day of Sha'ban. If the crescent of the new moon is seen, then the following day will be the first day of Ramadan. If it's not seen, Muslims continue 30 days of Sha'ban, then they start fasting the month of Ramadan straight after. Now we'll talk about who is obligated to fast. Now basically not every person is obligated to fast regardless of his situation. Rather, in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not ordain upon someone what is beyond his ability. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. One is not obligated to do what is beyond his ability. So when we talk about fasting, we need to mention who is obligated to fast, number one. Now first of all, the one obligated to fast must be Muslim. The one who is a child under puberty is not obligated to fast as well. However, it is the responsibility of the guardian, like his father, to order him to pray after the completion of 7 lunar years if he can tolerate fasting. If his body can tolerate fasting physically, then the guardian is obligated to order his son or his daughter to fast upon the completion of 7 lunar years. Some children might reach the age of mental discrimination before the completion of 7 lunar years, at the age of 5. Some kids are very smart. So at the age of 5, they can discriminate between things. They can comprehend questions and respond with correct answers. So they become what we call mumayyiz. They can start praying and fasting, and it's better for the guardian to tell them to pray and fast even before the completion of 7 lunar years, because they are mumayyiz already. However, as an obligation, the obligation starts on the guardian when the child reaches 7 or completes 7 lunar years. Now, if his body can tolerate fasting, then the guardian must order him to fast as he orders him to pray. And he must teach them as well the rules of praying and fasting and what pertains to that. The apostate must make up the days he missed out during his apostasy period after re-embracing Islam. Meaning if someone, let us say, apostatized for 1 year and he missed the days of fasting. When he apostatized, he stopped. Of course, basically, he left Islam, he's not praying, he's not fasting. Then after 2, 3, 4 years, whatever, he came back to Islam. This apostate is ordered to make up the days he missed of fasting. His case is not similar to the non-believer by origin, because the non-believer by origin is not asked to make up any of the missed prayers or days of fasting while he was a non-believer. And this is to encourage them to embrace Islam. So even if a non-believer by origin embraces Islam at the age of 60, he's not obligated to make up any of the prayers before or the days of fasting he missed before. This is an encouragement for them. So once they embrace Islam, all the past sins will be wiped out. And they won't be liable to make up any of the prayers they didn't make because they were non-believers, or to fast as they make up any of the days of fasting that they previously missed due to being non-believers. That's an encouragement for them. But this case does not apply to the apostate, because the apostate knew the truth, he was on the right path, then he apostatized. This is very abhorrent. This is very ugly, that he was on the right path, he knew the truth, now he apostatized, let us say 3, 4 years, then he came back to Islam. This one is ordered to make up the missed days of fasting. Also, the one who cannot physically tolerate fasting is not obligated to fast, either due to an old age, he's around 90, his body is very weak, he cannot tolerate fasting, he's not obligated to fast. Same with the one with a type of sickness that most likely he's not going to be recovered from, like being paralyzed. Some people with brain damage, that brain damage will cause the person to be paralyzed, and most likely it cannot be rectified, this situation. So most likely he's going to remain like this. When that's the case, such a person is not obligated to fast as well. He cannot tolerate fasting now, and because most likely this sickness will stay with him until death, so he's not obligated to make them up as well. So the one who cannot tolerate fasting because of a physical inability to fast, like the one who is very old, or the one who is sick with a type of sickness he's not hoping to be recovered from, is not obligated to fast nor to make them up. Because that one, even with an old age, he's not expecting his health to be better. He's deteriorating. His health is deteriorating down, down, down. So he's not obligated to fast when he cannot physically tolerate it, and he's not obligated to make them up. Same with the one who is sick with a type of sickness that he doesn't hope to be recovered from as well. Now, there is another excuse as well. When the lady is unable to fast due to religious reason. When we say due a religious reason, we're talking about physically she can, but religiously she can't. That's when she's in her menstruation period or in the postpartum bleeding period. After birth, she bleeds, usually for about 40 days. During these 40 days, while she's bleeding, she cannot fast religiously. But physically, she might be able to fast. but religiously she is unable to. They are not obligated to fast, and if they were to fast in that situation, the fasting is invalid, and they have to make up these days of fasting they have missed. The one who is sick and his sickness is most likely temporarily, will not last for a long period of time, so he's expecting to be recovered from that sickness soon. But now, at this stage, he's very sick, he cannot tolerate fasting. He is not obligated to fast, but he is obligated to make them up. He's expecting to be recovered. Someone had an operation during the month of Ramadan. When he had the operation, he had to break his fast for 3 days. Due to that operation, he cannot tolerate fasting. So this person has to make them up, because he is expecting to be better later on, so he will be healthy again and he will be able to make them up. Now, when we say that the menstruating lady and the lady that is in her postpartum bleeding period are not allowed to fast because fasting is not valid from them. However, they do not have to eat or drink if it's not with the intention of acceptable fasting. Let us say, for instance, a lady was invited to break her fast to some of the relatives' houses, let us say, and just before sunset, by 1 hour, she had her period. So now there is 1 hour left for sunset. She knows that her fast has been invalidated by seeing the blood, and that her fast is invalid, and that she has to make it up later on. But the question is, does she have to eat or drink before sunset? She doesn't have to, as long as it's not with the intention of making a proper fasting, because she knows her fast is invalid in that case. But she doesn't have to eat or drink before sunset. The menstruating lady and the lady that is in her postpartum bleeding period, and everyone that broke his fast due to an excuse or the like, they must make up the missed days, except the two cases we mentioned, the one who did not fast due to an old age, his body cannot physically tolerate fasting. This person cannot fast now, cannot fast later, so he's not obligated to fast now, he's not obligated to make him up later. And he will pay the expiation. We're going to talk about it soon, inshallah. Same with the one who is sick with a type of sickness that most likely he's not going to be recovered from. He cannot fast now, and he's not expecting to be recovered from that sickness later, so he can make up the days. So he pays an expiation as well. He doesn't make them up. The traveler who is traveling, a traveling distance of 2 days, 2 day traveling distance. If someone were to walk for a 2 day traveling distance, the scholars gave an estimation for this travel, and they said it's 8 farsakhs. Farsakh, it's a unit of length. They used to use it in the past. Every farsakh is 3 Islamic miles. When we say 3 Islamic miles, This is different from the customary mile, which is 1.6 kilometer. That's different from it. The Islamic mile, the scholars had different estimation for its length, but according to the school of Imam Shafi'i, what is famous is that the Islamic mile is 6,000 cubits. Now, if we say 6,000 cubits, will be approximately 138 kilometers. 138 kilometers. So if one is traveling such a distance, 2-day walking distance, which is approximately 138 kilometers according to one of the sayings, he is allowed not to fast. He is allowed not to fast. Even if fasting is not tedious for him, meaning he doesn't feel a hardship in this fast. Like, for instance, if you were to travel from Sydney to Canberra in a car these days, the car is comfortable, you have air condition, very comfortable. So although from Sydney to Canberra you have about 285 kilometers, so it's a long distance, it is more than the 2-day walking distance. So it takes you about 3 hours to get there. Now, but even with 3-hour drive these days, it's not tedious. There is no hardship in this travel. Is one allowed not to fast if he is traveling in a car or in an aeroplane? Yes, he is allowed not to fast. However, as Allah said in the Quran, وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. If it's not tedious, if you don't find a hardship in this travel, it's better to remain fasting, not to break your fast. So these days, because it's easier than the olden days where they used to travel on a camel in the desert, there was a great hardship in fasting in that situation in the past. But the consideration here is by distance. We're not talking about the means of transportation. We're not talking about the means of transportation. This is not considered. So whether you travel by a car or you travel by an aeroplane or by a rocket, that's not the consideration. The consideration is, if you travel that traveling distance, even by ship, if you travel that traveling distance, you are allowed not to fast. However, you need to make it up anyway. You need to make it up later on if you choose not to fast that day. Which is better? The better is, if you can fast without harming yourself because you're not experiencing any hardship in that situation, then in that case it's better for you to remain fasting. Provided that there is something very important here, that you need to leave the boundaries of your hometown before dawn. Before dawn you have to leave the boundaries of your hometown. But if you start the travel at 8 o'clock in the morning, which is after sunrise, you are not allowed to break the fast of that day, even if you are traveling to Lebanon by plane. That day you are not allowed to break its fast. But while you are on the way for other days, on the way, you are allowed. But for that day, because you initiated your travel after dawn, then you are not allowed to break your fast. If you travel before dawn, that's when you are allowed to break your fast. Like, for instance, let us say, if the plane is at 10 o'clock at night, you are traveling at 10 o'clock at night, that's the flight. So you leave, that means the country, before dawn. When you are traveling, after you fly, let us say 1 hour or less, you'll be definitely leaving the boundaries of your hometown while you are in the plane. Then on the way, dawn breaks, You can break that fast. While you are traveling, you can break that fast. We have also another reason to take into consideration as well. Which is, one's travel is not sinful. Because this is a facility for one who is traveling not to break in case he finds himself in need of not fasting that day. He finds a bit of hardship, so he can break his fast. But if he is traveling a sinful travel, he is not allowed to break his fast. That's something important as well. So, we mentioned the distance must be a traveling distance. Second, he must establish his travel before dawn, and his travel is not sinful. So if these three conditions are met, one is allowed not to fast while being a traveler. The one who becomes sick during the month of Ramadan, and that's very important to talk about, who becomes sick during the month of Ramadan is allowed to break his fast, provided that that sickness, if he were to fast while having that sickness, he will find a hardship equivalent to the hardship that allows one to perform the dry purification instead of performing wudu. Because, you know, if someone is burnt, if he were to use water on his organs, he cannot tolerate. There is a hardship to put water on his burnt face and hands. So there is a hardship. That level of hardship that is considered here, we're talking about the same level of hardship for the one who becomes sick during the month of Ramadan and finds an equivalent hardship where he cannot continue fasting that day. This means not if you find, let us say, a bit of headache, that means you say, I'm sick, I want to break my fast. Not when you have a bit of fever, you say, I want to break my fast. Not when you say, my stomach is aching, that means you want to break your fast. Now, all these things are not to that level of hardship that is considered Islamically. That's expected to have headache, to have stomach ache, dry throat. That's expected, especially if you are fasting in a hot weather. In a hot weather, yeah, you feel your throat is cracked. Now here, alhamdulillah, it's very easy. We are fasting in winter, but in some countries now, you know, they break the fast at 10:30 at night. That's the sunset for them at about 10:30 at night. So they fast, some of them, 18 hours, 19 hours, 20 hours in some regions these days. That's a long day. Yeah, so they are expected to do what? They are expected to find a hardship. But what type of hardship that allows them to break the fast? It's not just headache or fever or stomach ache. It has to be a severe hardship, similar, equivalent to the hardship that one would experience if he were to use water when performing wudu, and in that case he becomes allowed to perform tayammum, the dry purification. So the scholars drew an analogy between this hardship and that hardship, just to make it closer for one to make proper estimation. So in what case I'm allowed to break my fast if I get sick during Ramadan? Even sometimes if you start vomiting, that doesn't mean you are allowed to break your fast for just vomiting. Now you vomit, you wash your mouth, and you continue fasting. But when the hardship escalates, it reaches a stage where you find yourself, if you were to continue fasting, you will be harmed. Then you are not allowed to harm yourself. Then you break your fast in that case. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, "Man zara'ahu al-qay' wa huwa sa'im, falaysa alayhi qada'. Wa man istaqa'a falyaqdi." Man zara'ahu al-qay', the one who was overcome by the vomit, meaning he vomited involuntarily, فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ قَضَاءٌ, meaning his fast remains valid, he needs to wash his mouth and continue fasting that day. وَمَنِ اسْتَقَاءَ, that's the induced vomit, meaning deliberate vomiting. He forced himself to vomit by putting his finger inside his mouth. That invalidates his fast when he vomits, even if he doesn't swallow any of the vomit back in. Because he took him out deliberately, that invalidated his fast. So that's something to be careful about. Also, the breastfeeding woman and the pregnant woman. The breastfeeding woman or the nursing woman or the pregnant woman. Now, in some cases, they might find a hardship on themselves where they cannot tolerate fasting themselves. They find a hardship in fasting. Sometimes they can tolerate fasting, but there is a probability that the baby will be affected. In what way? She knows when she fasts that she won't have sufficient milk in her breast to feed the baby. Or if she's pregnant, she won't have enough food as nutrition for the baby. So the baby won't be growing as it should because it's not getting sufficient nutrition when that lady is pregnant, if she doesn't eat. Now, we have two cases. When she's worried about herself, because due, for instance, either an experience before, she knows herself, she tried to fast before while being pregnant, she found herself unable to. That's one case. The other case is when a trustworthy doctor would tell her, you cannot fast because fasting will affect your health. You have such and such, and in fasting for this period of time without taking the medicine, whatever, it will affect you. Based on the statement of trustworthy doctors who mentioned to her that fasting will affect you, or fasting will affect your baby, then she is allowed not to fast in that case. Now, what does she have to do in that case? The situation depends on what reason she's breaking the fast for. If she is not fasting because of her fear for herself, she gets harmed, she gets dizzy, she collapses, that's from previous experience. So she breaks the fast because she finds herself unable to fast, then she has to make up these days and she doesn't have to pay any expiation. However, if she breaks the fast merely for the baby, out of her fear for the baby, as we mentioned, either she might have miscarriage or she won't have sufficient milk for the baby, she is allowed to break her fast in that case. She has to make them up, plus she has to pay an expiation. The expiation is for each day, according to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, for each day, mud. average sized hands cupped together, filled with the most common staple food of that region. Like in many countries, the most common staple food is wheat. You know, when they make bread from it, that's the most common staple food. In some regions, like Indonesia, Malaysia, it's rice. So rice will be the most common staple food. So depending on which staple food, most common staple food is for that region. For each day, she pays a mud to a poor person. For each day. So every day, because she's not fasting that day, she would give one mud to a poor person. Then she has to make them up later on. By this we finish talking about who is obligated to fast. And now we talk about the integrals of fasting. Now we'll talk about one integral. The first integral is the intention. The intention must be established at night. When we say at night, the night starts by sunset, finishes by dawn. Anytime between sunset and dawn, one must establish the intention to fast the following day of Ramadan. Now he can have in his heart the intention, such as to say in his heart, Nawaitu siyama yawmi ghad. That's the best. عن أداء فرض رمضان هذه السنة إيمانا واحتسابا لله تعالى. So that's the best, to have all this in your heart at night. But if you were to intend in your heart, I now intend to fast tomorrow of Ramadan, that is sufficient. Even some scholars said, waking up at night for suhoor, to eat for suhoor, while you are waking up at night, to eat at night before dawn, to fast the following day of Ramadan. Some scholars, they said that waking up at night to eat, so you can be prepared to fast the following day, this is on itself is classified as an intention. Even at sunset, when you are breaking the fast after sunset, if let us say you had in your heart, today I felt hungry, I want to eat more now so I can last tomorrow, I can have stronger energy tomorrow, inshallah. So you are eating more with the intention of you are fasting tomorrow. This is classified as an intention. Now at least between sunset and dawn, put in your heart the intention that you want to fast the following day of Ramadan. For each day, according to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhum, each day is a separate act of worship. He said, it's like subh prayer, then zuhr, then asr, then maghrib, then isha. So every prayer is separate. You cannot just wake up in the morning and say, I intend to pray five prayers during the day, and that will be sufficient for all the prayers during the day. No. For each prayer, you need to intend. I now intend to pray the obligatory zuhr. I now intend to pray the obligatory asr, and so on. Imam al-Shafi'i said, as each prayer is separate from the other prayer, by something that is against praying, doesn't agree with the concept of praying, like you finish the prayer by assalamu alaikum, so you terminated your prayer, you finished it. Now, you would go, walk, eat. That does not agree with the concept of prayer. Then you have asr. He said, same. After sunset, you eat, drink, which does not agree with the concept of fasting. That means for the following day, you need to establish a new intention. So Imam al-Shafi'i said, for every day of fasting, you must establish the intention at night to fast the following day. So what happens if someone did not establish the intention at all to fast the following day? And this could happen. Let us say, they're not sure if tomorrow is the first day of Ramadan or not. They haven't determined yet. Someone was waiting to receive the news about the beginning of Ramadan. Then he went to sleep. He woke up at 8 o'clock in the morning. And they told him, Ramadan already started. So for this day, he did not establish the intention at night to fast it. What does he have to do? Because Ramadan already started, for out of respect for the month, he is not allowed to eat or drink during the day, although his fast is invalid. So he will continue the day as if he is fasting. He abstains from all the invalidators of fasting, and he has to make up the day of fasting. Why? Because it is an obligation, obligatory fasting. For each obligatory fasting, according to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, the intention must be established at night. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَمْ يُبَيِّتِ الصِّيَامَ قَبْلَ الْفَجْرِ فَلَا صِيَامَ لَهُ. Clearly it says, the one who does not establish the intention for fasting at night for the following day, then his fast is invalid. That's because it is an obligatory fasting. The optional fasting is different. The optional fasting you have up to noon time. Up to noon time, provided that you did not eat or drink anything before. Let us say you woke up at 9 o'clock in the morning and someone said to you, are you fasting today? And you say, what is today? They tell you today is the 15th day of Sha'ban. It's recommended to fast the 15th day of Sha'ban. It's sunnah, recommended. Then you can have the intention, okay, I'll fast this day for the sake of Allah. Then your fast is valid. So you establish the intention before noon. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam many times would ask his wife if they have a type of food in the morning. And when she says, we don't have food, and he would say, I'll fast this day for the sake of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast frequently. Our Lady Aisha radiallahu anha said once, we used to say he fasts to an extent that we could never realize him not fasting. Meaning he used to fast a lot, frequent fasting. And he would not fast in other days as well, that we could identify him not fasting as well. So the Prophet never used to fast every single day of the year. Rather, he used to fast many days of the year, especially in Sha'ban, which is the month preceding Ramadan. He used to fast a lot, the months we are in now. He used to fast during the month of Sha'ban. But he never fasted a one full month, except for Ramadan. One full month, only Ramadan. So one needs as well to identify the reason for his fast. So if he's fasting of Ramadan, he should in his heart identify this, such as to say in his heart, I now intend to fast tomorrow of Ramadan. Now if he is fasting as a fulfillment of an expiation or a vow, he needs to mention, I am fasting tomorrow as a fulfillment of a vow. He needs to establish this intention at night as well. The expiation, he needs to mention as well in his heart, I fast tomorrow as a fulfillment of expiation, even without specifying the reason for the expiation. Because the expiation is not only what we talked about. For instance, the expiation could be, you know, if someone breaks the oath, he swears by Allah Azza wa Jal not to do something, then he breaks that oath and he does it. Here, if he's able to feed 10 poor Muslims or clothe them one piece of garment each, or to free a Muslim slave, which might not be applicable these days. So if he is unable to do any of the three, the second option is to fast the 3 days. So this is expiation for breaking the oath. That's an expiation for breaking the oath. Also, there are other types of expiation where one is in need of fasting. The expiation will be fasting as well. So he doesn't have to specify, I'm fasting tomorrow as fulfillment of expiation for such and such reason. He doesn't have to mention this. It's sufficient to intend to fast the following day as a fulfillment of an expiation. Now, according to Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, he said, on the first night of the month of Ramadan, one is allowed to intend to fast 30 days of Ramadan this year. And that intention will be sufficient for the whole month. So he classified fasting the whole month as one act of worship that needs one intention. He said, provided that you make this intention on the first night of fasting. So you intend in your heart to fast 30 days of Ramadan this year, which is the maximum you would fast, 30 days. It might be 29 days, but you intend to fast 30 days of Ramadan this year. Then you don't have to repeat this intention for every day. Now that's why we say, for one to be on the safe side, when they announce the beginning of Ramadan, put the intention according to Imam Malik to fast 30 days of Ramadan, and put the intention to fast the following day according to Imam Shafi'i. Then every day, try to remember this intention. If you forget the intention at any day, you already put the intention according to Imam Malik to fast 30 days of Ramadan, so you don't have to make up these days. Also, according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, he said, for Ramadan especially, it's like fasting the optional days, optional recommended days. He said, the time for the intention extends up to noon time. That's according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu. So according to him, in the example that we mentioned according to Imam Shafi'i, now if you were to apply according to the rules of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, if you wake up in the morning at 9 o'clock and they tell you Ramadan has started, you can establish the intention to fast this day of Ramadan. And that will be, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, a valid intention at that time. Because according to him, it's like the optional fasting. The time of the intention extends up to noon time. That's in Ramadan. I'm not talking about making up days. For making up days, it's different. So even according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, you don't wake up in the morning and you say, I want to fast this as a makeup. If you haven't established the intention at night, you cannot do this. But he said Ramadan is special, and that's different for him. He classified it regarding the intention as the optional fasting, which time extends up to noon time. That's according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu. We ask Allah to increase our knowledge, benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired, and gather us on the day of judgment with those who are knowledgeable, like Imam Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, Malik, and Ahmad. Ameen. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.